The bandwidth is a huge problem on mobile phones. Then there's the problem of art direction, and means that if you want to present your site on a mobile phone differently than on a desktop, you needed to be able to switch your image with another image, but not using the same aspect ratio. Our company built for Drupal 7 two modules to solve the problem. They're called Breakpoints and Pictures. Picture is later renamed to Responsive Images in Drupal 8 Core, but it's basically the same principle. So the evolution of the picture tag, it started with the source set that was added by Apple in the CSS, so you could define multiple background images. There was a first try in 2012, but it never succeeded. There was not enough browsers interested in the problem. In September 2013, we had a meeting in Paris with all browser builders, trying to explain to them why we needed a solution. At the end of the meeting, there was no conclusion. So eventually, Jof Weiss started writing the code for Blink to support Picture. And at that moment, people from Firefox also jumped on and said that they would support it as well. It is, for the moment, available in Chrome 38 and in the latest version of Firefox that should be released in, like, 2 weeks or so. Okay. The people from the filament group, Scott Yale, they created a polyfill for picture tag that is now being used as well by the Drupal 7 module as Drupal 8 core. The polyfill works on most browsers. The problem you're probably going to face is that Internet Explorer 8 is not going to support media queries correctly, so the output of picture is probably not going to be as expected. So when do you use picture? There are four cases when you are better to use picture instead of a plain image tag. The first one is that if you need different sizes. The next one is if you would one support for retina displays, so, and that's for the moment most all new phones are retina displays. So for instance, the Nexus 5 of Google has a DPI of 3, meaning that you have 3 pixels plotted on 1 pixel. Another use case is mime types. If you want to output WebP format images to save bandwidth, you need a way to support browser that has support for WebP and which is Chrome for the moment, because the huge advantage of WebP is that it's at least 20% smaller than JPEG files. And the last case is the art direction. There are cases when you better don't use picture. For instance, if you have a small logo on your site, there's no need to provide different sizes, so you can use it on all devices. You use the same image. Things like avatars, things like banners and ads, especially if they're third party, it's going to be difficult to wrap their outputs and switch it to picture. And if you're using SVG, you don't have the problem of the scaling and the bandwidth. So breakpoints. Breakpoints are basically media queries. They're for the moment used in CSS files or in SAS, so you can target different media with a different set of CSS. The Breakpoints module in Drupal 8 core uses exactly the same breakpoints as defined in your CSS. So there are two types of breakpoints. You have breakpoints you use to define the layout of your page. So you say on a mobile device, I want all my blocks, I mean my navigation at the top and then my content. On a desktop, I want my navigation on the left and I want my content on the right. And then there is also breakpoints you use for your content to define how your content has to react depending mostly on the width of your screen. Okay, so breakpoints for layout, they are defined in your team.breakpoints.yaml file. So each team has to ship with such a file that defines the breakpoints. There is in Drupal 8 core no UI to define your own breakpoints. They have to be defined inside your team. So the ones for, so I made a small demo site. So you have a layout that defines your page. So it's a mobile first approach. So you have a page and then regions. They're all 100% white. And then you have a container that contains your blocks. So on a tablet, the layout changes that your sidebar, so the region sidebar, moves to the left and the content moves to the right. So, and at the top you can see that there's a breakpoint added. So if the width is 38 ms, you get this layout. ITC is as applied, and so it changes your layout. Since that's the same layout we're going to be using on the desktop, there's nothing that you need to define inside your CSS. So the breakpoints that you saw in the CSS are the same. The only addition is there is a mobile breakpoint with an empty media query. So that's added so it can be used later on by the picture module to do his job. So, and you see a narrow breakpoint, that's for the 38M, and you see the wide breakpoint for the 50M. So the layout looks something like this. You have a header at the top. The orange one is the sidebar and the green one is the content. And on a tablet, you have the header still at the top and the sidebar to the left, content to the right, and the same for the desk, for desktop version. So now we have breakpoints needed for our layout, but we still need to define the layout of our page, how our content is going to react. So on the desktop, we want our image floated to the left with the text wrapping around it. So we need to define with a 50M breakpoint or the wide breakpoint that it has to flow to the left and the text will be wrapping to the right. So I added the dimensions, I have the rough dimensions of the images. So mobile, you have a banner at the top that's as full width, so 240 pixels wide and 90 pixels in height. The content image is also full width. And on tablets, the layout changes that the banner image gets another dimension and the image for the content is scaled to full width. And then on desktop, we wanted the layout that the text is wrapping around the image. So the image gets smaller as on a tablet. So if we have all of this, the next thing we have to do is we have to define responsive image mappings. So we need to define a mapping to tell Drupal what the connection is between a certain breakpoint and a certain image style we want to use to output the image. So adding responsive images is pretty straightforward for the moment. So you have to enter a name and select the breakpoint group. You have to select image styles and save it. So that's a screen for adding a mapping. So you give it a name. This one is called content image because it's going to control the image in the content. You select the breakpoint group, which is basically, or is normally always your theme you're using, but modules are also able to define breakpoints. So that's added so Contrib can later on build modules that works with breakpoints as well. So if you select the breakpoint group and you hit save, you get a list of all your breakpoints. So the 1x is a multiplier that defines the DPI of the screen. So basically, they're all you always have a 1x multiplier, but later on you can add others as well. So you see the white breakpoint, the narrow breakpoint, and the mobile one. And then the three at the bottom are field sets, so you can click on it and they slide open. So you can then select the image style you want to use for each of them. So I created image styles, content image, desk, tablet, and mobile, and I just mapped them on that screen. So for the banner in the sidebar, we have to do the same. So we just enter the name, select the same breakpoint group, and we add the mappings as well. So we choose for tablets, both on narrow and wide, because the image stays the same on both tablets and desktops. So to control the output, it's similar as it is in Drupal 7. Since Views is part of Drupal 8, the output of the banner is controlled by View. So this is a basic view. It has the image field. If you click on it, you can select the responsive image formatter, and you can select the mapping that the responsive image mapping that has to be used for the output. You also see the fallback image. The fallback image is needed if the browser doesn't support picture or the polyfill, or if the user is not using JavaScript. So if they disable JavaScript and they don't have native support for the picture element, they will see the fallback image. So for the image in the content, we have to do the same, but this time we use the field formatter. So if you go to the Manage Displays page, you can select the formatter and change it from image to a responsive image. You select your mapping the same, and you select the fallback image style. So, and depending on how you design your site, you either select the smallest available or the biggest available. So if you want to support IE8, the safe bet is to select the big picture, assuming that all browsers are going to be IE8. So most browsers automatically updated, like Firefox and Chrome, so they will are sooner going to be adapting the picture and supporting it. So I build a small demo of this. Okay. Yeah, it's zoomed in. Moment. Okay, so this is a demo site. So on the left, the little ducks is the banner image. On the right, you see the image and the text wrapping around it. So if I make my screen smaller, so this is a tablet, so the image is displayed on the full width of the content, and with the text is then moved to the bottom. The banner image stays the same, and if you go to a mobile device, the ducks are displayed at the top, and the image of the content is also full width. So and. Wait. The screen is too small. So the thing the picture module is doing is it's outputting a picture tag. So you have the picture element, and picture element contains sources. So for each breakpoint you use in your responsive image mapping, you get a source tech edit. So this one is for the 50M, and the source set defines which file that has to be used. So for 50M, it uses the banner tablets. For the tablet one, it uses a tablet as well, and for the mobile one, it uses the mobile image style to output it. The green comments are needed because IE9 doesn't like the use of source text. So if the comments are not added or stripped during rendering, IE9 will display all these by default because it assumes that what you're outputting is a video instead of a picture element. So, and the thing the polyfill does is that it changes the fallback image on the fly. So you can see which one is used. On this screen, the mobile one is used. If you have native support, there's no easy way for the moment to tell which picture is actually used. So it can be a little bit hard to find potential problems. So for the moment, we have one image outputted for each breakpoint, but the problem is on the mobile screen, this image is exactly the same image if it's this wide as this one. So it means that for this image, you're downloading way too much data to output it, because this is approximately 200 pixels wide. If you go near the size of the tablet, this is almost 500 pixels wide. So we need a way to refine extra images so we can save on the bandwidth. So there are the problems with the better image that you saw is between the mobile and the tablet breakpoint, but to render it properly on the widest possible, you need to make it as wide as the tablet's. And for the content image, you have the same image between mobile and the tablet breakpoint. You have one image that's used all over the time. So these are the problems. There are two solutions for those problems. So the first one and the old one was adding more breakpoints in your team. So you had a breakpoint for 38M, at one for 30M, 26M, 20M, all the way down. The problem is you have a lot of breakpoints that you have to add, and you have to repeat your mappings all over the time. So there's a new solution. And that uses sizes, and sizes allows you to react on the width of the browser screen. So it has nothing to do with the size of the image, it's the size of the browser screen. So to do that, we have to change our mappings. And there's a third option. There's an option to use sizes. And sizes, you define how wide you expect your picture to be on a certain width of a screen. So, and it has a new unit added, is VW from viewport, and it allows you to say, okay, I want 100 VW, meaning 100% of my viewport width. So for the banner, we need our banner to be as wide as our device. So in sizes, we can just say, okay, we want 100% of our viewport width all the time. So I created a new set of image mappings. So I have to change my settings in my view. And then for the content image, we have something different. So there are sizes. Yeah, and it's hard to read, but at the bottom, the sizes are mean width 38M, which is the breakpoint we use. And on that width, if that is true, we want the image to be 70% of the width of our screen. And in all other cases, we want it to be 100% of the width of our screen. So for the sizes, yeah, first to define the sizes itself, and then you have to select the image size you want to use. So what we normally do is we create image styles W200, W400, W600, but so, and those are simple resizers, so they resize the image to that width. You have to change your settings in the display, and then I'm going to try to do it live. So these are the settings of our content image. So I change my mapping to the new one I created. So I call it content with sizes. You have to hit save at the bottom. So, and for the banner block, do something similar. You have so the image, and it changes to the banner width sizes. If you save this and go back to the site, yeah. So there's visually nothing changed. It's exactly the same, but if we So if you look at the output now, so you see that for the source, there are a lot of image styles added to it. So, and the browser knows which one to choose depending on what you defined in size. So in the easy case where you say size is 100% of my viewport, the browser knows how wide your screen is, and it knows how many dpi your screen is. So it just multiplies the dpi with the width of your screen. So if you have a 320 pixel wide screen with 3 dpi's, you get 960 pixels. It scans the list of the break of the source sets to find the best matching source of the image, and that's the one that gets loaded. So if you do it properly, you can define multiple image styles for different reads, and you can save a lot of bandwidth, and your site will render a lot faster, especially on mobile phones. So, but this still means that as a site builder, that you have to define 10 or 20 image styles, you have to define all your mappings. But since Drupal 8 has support for config files, and the themes and modules in Drupal 8 are essentially the same, it allows themes also to define config. So what themers can do to make it easier for people using their theme, they can define the breakpoints in the breakpoints YAML file, but they can also define all the image styles they think are appropriate for a site in the config install, and they can do the same with responsive image mappings in config install. So if they put all of those into their config install, the moment the theme gets installed, the site builder has all the image styles and has all the responsive image mappings out of the box. There are still some problems with the picture element, because it reacts on the width of your screen, meaning if you have a 30-inch screen and you maximize your browser, the calculations are going to be done with that size. So the browser at 100% viewport width is going to be the same as 2,500 pixels, and the picture element is going to load the highest possible source set that it is defined. So there's a solution for it, and it's called element queries. That allows, but that's still a proposal, that allows you to react on the width of the container of your image. So if your image is in a region content, and that region is only 500 pixels wide, you can say that the 100% viewport width is that 500 pixels. So we'll get better control of the output. But that's still a proposal. The responsive image community group is working on it. But they have still to convince browsers that it's really needed. This is a list of Drupal 8 issues. So for the moment, Drupal 8 is not up to date with the polyfill. So that needs to be done. The sooner the better. There's also an issue created to discuss the use of the polyfill, because there are people worrying that it's going to be abused instead of used correctly. There are people saying that it would be better to not use the polyfill, but just output picture and force people or browsers in that way to update sooner. But that's a discussion that still has to be held. The UI needs some work, because for the moment it's way too complex, especially if you have a lot of breakpoints and a lot of image styles. It's not easy to use. There's still a problem with AJAX callbacks in Drupal 8, and there is an issue that should be ready that allows you to change the MIME type of your file. So you could say, I want my users to upload a JPEG file, but I want to convert it on the fly to WebP format, so I can use that. There's still some other issues needed for the GD toolkit, because for the moment there's no support for other image formats. I made a list of couple of blog posts about sizes and source sets, because for most people it might be intimidating in the beginning, because it's a complex thing. There's a lift. There's a link to the draft of the spec, and there's a kind of a formal spec for the moment. Browser supports is added. So for the moment, Chrome and Firefox and Opera are having support for it. IE is still considering the use of picture, but normally they will add it to IE 12. And Safari or Apple has still no formal decision if they're going to use it or not. So for the moment, for Safari and for Internet Explorer, you will need a polyfill. There's a tool called Sizer Soze that allows you to scan a website to see how much you can save if you use the picture tech. For most sites that are not optimized, that can be a lot. There's a list of use cases for picture and some other blog posts about the picture fill. Some people I like to thank is Jelle Seebrechts, who wrote a lot of the patches for Drupal 8 and who is co-maintaining the Drupal 7 modules. Mark Drummond, who is helping to get all issues fixed as soon as possible. The Responsive Images Community Group, who started with the proposal for the picture element and who developed it. The Filament Group, because they are still maintaining the picture polyfill. Joaf Wise is the guy who wrote the code for Blink. And Marcos Casera is an open source lead in the Firefox team. I have to remind you that Friday is a sprint and that the more people that are coming to help, the sooner that Drupal 8 will be released. So, if anybody has questions? Okay, then I guess that's it. Oh, wait. I'm sorry? No. The Breakpoint module, the only thing the Breakpoint module does in Drupal 8 is read the Breakpoint YAML file from your team and expose it as a kind of config settings to responsive images. So the output is controlled by the picture module. Anybody? Okay, thank you.